so much for joining us tonight's discussion on planning for the just city. My name is Mitra Anderson-Oliver. I'm the president of the Melbourne University's Planning Student Society. 2 years young, it's the aim of MUPSS to be a voice and advocate for students studying planning here at the University of Melbourne, and in doing so, to promote and publicise the important conversations shaping our cities. Tonight, we think, is certainly one of those. Last week, as I'm sure you're all well aware, Melbourne's newest metropolitan planning strategy, Plan Melbourne, was released, placing Melbourne 2030 into early retirement and outlining a new vision for Melbourne out to 2050. I'd like to especially thank the panel for agreeing to join us tonight to discuss the question, what would a more just and socially equitable future for Melbourne look like, and how can it be achieved? What opportunities and challenges does this new strategy offer in achieving the just city? Our panellists are each going to talk to us for 10 minutes tonight in answer to this question, which I realise is not a very long amount of time to digest a huge amount of information in a short period, but we're very keen to hear from you and get your questions of the panellists tonight. It's important for me to add at this point that tonight's event will be filmed at the back, and if you have any issues with this and with being filmed, please do let us know and we'll do something about it and edit you out. It's MUPSS's great pleasure to be able to host this event tonight and to have the opportunity to hear from these esteemed voices. James Conlon, who's the MUPSS Education and Industry Officer, has spent many hours crafting and coordinating this incredible panel, and I'd like to invite him to introduce each member.
Thanks, Mitra. So I'm just going to quickly introduce our panel so we can get moving on tonight and get onto the great discussion. So first of all, Professor Roz Hansen. She has 30 years experience in the planning profession, including many years as managing director at award-winning consultancy Hansen Partnership. She is also founder of Roz Hansen Consulting. Most relevant to tonight, Roz was chairperson for the Ministerial Advisory Committee for the new Metropolitan Planning Strategy, as I'm sure we've all read. Roz is a certified practicing planner, fellow of the Planning Institute of Australia and the Victorian Planning and Environmental Law Association, adjunct professor at Deakin University, Victorian Councillor for the Property Council of Australia, and recipient of an Australian Government Centenary Medal. Jane Monk is currently the Director of Planning Statutory Services in the Department of Transport, Planning and Local Infrastructure. She oversees environmental and major transport environmental and major project assessments for planning scheme amendments and ministerial planning permits. A Melbourne University graduate, Jane's experience includes planning in local government, her role as a senior member at VCAT, drafting of the Planning Environment Act, and chair of the Priority Development Panel for the former government. Jane is a fellow at PIA, the Victorian Planning and Environmental Law Association, plus a member for the faculty's Planning Advisory Committee. Lucinda Hartley is the CEO of CoDesign Studio, a not-for-profit social enterprise focusing on inclusive neighbourhoods and urban improvement projects. Lucinda has extensive community and international development experience, having worked with slum communities in Southeast Asia, as well as the UN, AusAid, and Habitat for Humanity. Her achievements include the 2012 Sinatra Leadership Award from the Australian Institute of Landscape Architects, as well as profiling in the Age Melbourne magazine in 2012, being described as one of Melbourne's most top 100 influential people. Dr. Kate Shaw is a fellow future in urban geography and planning at Melbourne University. Her current research focuses on urban renewal in the 21st century, and her background is in alternative cultures, live music, and gentrification. Kate's recent publications include Who's Urban Renaissance? An international comparison of urban regeneration policies, as well as numerous journal articles on urban renewal, indie subcultures, international students, and the creative city. Kay received the Association of European Schools of Planning Prize for Best Published Paper in 2005. Professor Susan Fainstein. Susan Fainstein is a senior research fellow in the Harvard Graduate School of Design. Her research interests include planning theory, urban theory, urban redevelopment, and comparative urban policy, focusing on the US, Europe, and East Asia. Her book publications, which many of us students have read in our studies, include The Just City, The City Builders, Property Politics and Planning in London and New York, Restructuring the City, and Urban Political Movements. She's authored over 100 book chapters in articles and scholarly journals. Her achievements include the Distinguished Educator Award of the Association of American Schools of Planning and the Davidoff Book Award. Susan has sat on numerous academic journal editorial boards. So there's a tremendous amount of experience and expertise between our speakers tonight, and we're all very excited for this great discussion. I'll hand back to Mitra if we can get the event started. Thanks.
Thank you, James. First up tonight, we have Professor Roz Hansen, who's going to give us a bit of context for the talk that we're doing tonight.
Livable, affordable, fair and just, particularly socially just. Metro Melbourne is revealing some disturbing, very disturbing and stark facts in relationship to communities that don't have reasonable access to good education, a range of job opportunities within a reasonable distance from home, affordable housing and reliable frequent public transport. Some have called it the Melbourne of two cities, others have called it the haves and have-nots. But what we are experiencing at the moment is a growing gap between those that can afford to live close to their workplace and also to good services, leaving others to be on the fringe of Melbourne and in the outer suburbs where we are deficient, particularly in regards to jobs and a range of community services. The widening backlog in the provision of childcare centres as well as primary and secondary schools, health and wellbeing facilities, particularly for those most in need of assistance, and the lack of access to jobs and services as well as shops is creating real problems for our city. But I'd say it's not all doom and gloom. We have an opportunity to plan our growth better, to manage our great city's urban future in a more integrated, socially responsible and equitable manner. I support the view that growth is good, that is, provided it is well managed and shares the prosperity that growth can generate to all members of our community. However, managing our growth will come at a cost, not just a monetary cost in terms of funding much needed city shaping and community building infrastructure, but a cost to some of us who wish to protect our neighbourhoods from accommodating more people and more services. Planning for a metropolis of 6.5 to 7 million people by 2050 will require sharing the benefits as well as sharing the responsibility of accommodating this growth. Planners will need to intervene and promote and deliver more equitable outcomes. Public policy should not discriminate, but rather be an enabler of the just city. Every time we prepare public policy or review current policy, we should be asking the question, is this policy just? If not, then what needs to be done to make that policy just and why? Today, I want to talk specifically about housing in the context of a just city. Regardless of our economic circumstances, all of us are entitled to have a safe and comfortable place to live. Having a home, be it to own or rent, is as important as having a good job and access to a decent education. At present, there are more than 22,000 people in Victoria in need of emergency accommodation each night. We are experiencing some of the worst overcrowding in rundown and poorly managed boarding houses. The cost of housing to purchase is rising. And despite the lowest interest rates we've seen in decades, there is a growing number of Melburnians and new arrivals who are never likely to be able to afford to buy their own home. This is particularly the case for many single people and single parent households. You cannot expect people to continue to pay at least 50% of their weekly salary on a mortgage or rent, particularly when the average salary is already well behind the cost of living. If we want a just city, then we need to address the issue of affordable housing. As importantly, we need to also provide more social housing. For decades, state governments have neglected the public housing sector, with every year the waiting list getting longer and the time to secure a public housing unit extended. For some people on the list, they have been waiting more than 10 years. We have over 40,000 people in Victoria waiting for public housing, and the challenge is getting worse every week. We must build more public social housing and more affordable housing generally. For me, it is the number one priority for Melbourne. State and local governments own land which is often strategically well located in terms of access to public transport, community services and job-dense areas. VicTrack alone has over 3,000 land holdings, many of which are either vacant or underutilised and yet close to railway stations. Mandating for change is considered by some to be undemocratic or highly interventionist. Well, planners, get over it. We are interventionists. That is what we do. We have been able to mandate against building heights, and in fact the recent residential zone review has mandated building heights. Plan Melbourne is proposing to mandate building heights in certain parts of the CBD and along certain waterways. So we are in a position to mandate certain things. Other cities have mandated that a percentage of new housing in large developments, including in urban renewal areas, must be affordable and or social housing. There are cities that have set themselves targets to provide X amount of affordable and social housing units by a defined date. If we are requiring local councils to prepare housing strategies or set housing targets to accommodate and anticipate population growth, then we are in a position to mandate for more affordable housing and social housing as part of those housing strategies. Both state and local government should be leaders in this space. If we are to have any hope of delivering more dwellings that are affordable to those most in need, it will be driven by leaders in the housing sector and not just the myriad of housing associations and NGOs. I'm also a strong believer in the carrot and stick approach to housing, and hence the important role that incentives can play in shaping the housing sector. There will be locations where we will need to include incentives in the planning approval regime to help offset the cost to the developer of providing more affordable and social housing units. We need to devise a set of incentives based on solid and sound land economics and property market feasibility, based on ensuring that we provide the housing that the population needs. In that regard, we cannot forget the point that every developer has to make a return on their investment, and that is why we need to understand how the housing market works, work with the market, and actually work with developers on an incentive-driven system. Plan Melbourne places a strong emphasis on accommodating more housing on strategically well-located sites within established urban areas, and not just in the expanded central city, but in other urban areas beyond, including the suburbs. The potential of these large sites needs to be unlocked and made to work much harder to alleviate our current and future housing needs. Often these primary development opportunities are well serviced with public transport and other urban assets, and by sweating these assets, we can do more with what we have. The newly created NPA will need to work in partnership with local councils in identifying the best strategically located suburban urban renewal opportunities. Once designated, government needs to work closely with the stakeholders in preparing overall development plans. Plans that include a desired land use mix, appropriate density, infrastructure needs, urban amenities, and delivering equitable outcomes. With further urban consolidation and intensification of our city, it is vital that we deliver more diversity in the housing market. An ageing population, growth in the single and two-person households, and a more ethnically mixed population will be some of the key drivers for housing diversity. Whilst I recognise that there is no clear relationship between diversity and equity, we can create diversity in our physical planning of our urban areas by providing housing and jobs for low-income households within such areas. I support the view that whatever it takes to make the least better off become better off in a good planning outcome situation, then the planning job is doing its job well. Our current housing market is rather bland, dominated by either the detached house or the towering apartment block. The market has failed to cater for different household types and income levels in a quantum that is needed to keep up with housing demand. We are seeing a downsizing in the floor plans of apartments to offset the cost of construction at the expense of internal living amenity. We're also seeing a formulaic approach to housing, whereby much of the innovation is more in the selection of materials and finishes than adaptable internal layouts and housing, which is essentially meeting people's needs as they grow older and household structures change. Somehow we need to encourage industrialisation of the housing sector, where dwellings can be built quicker and at a lower cost, but without the undermining the quality of our living amenity. Prefabrication, modular and unitised housing are ways of constructing more houses more quickly at a cheaper price. Can we privilege in the planning system our approval timelines for these types of housing? I believe almost anything is possible. You just have to work it to make it happen. Plan Melbourne proposes a code assess system in the housing sector of extending the Vic Smart program to facilitate the delivery of well-designed multi-dwelling development as well as affordable housing. Some developers are resorting to building timber apartment blocks as a means of cutting out union labour costs, whilst others are experimenting with modular housing modules. But we will need to make many more initiatives to invigorate a more innovative and affordable housing market, and we're really just touching the edges of the iceberg. I believe a just city is a city that delivers a diverse range of housing at affordable prices in different locations close to jobs and services. And this brings me to my final comment on Melbourne becoming a just city: access to jobs and services. There is little merit in constructing housing which is not readily accessible to shops and services, jobs and good public transport. There is nothing just about living in an urban growth area which fails to deliver basic community building services for many years hence. There is nothing just about living in an established suburb where the bus services every 40 minutes and takes you to the nearest railway station that happens to go in a different direction to where your place of work or education is located. There is nothing just about having to live in a suburb which may fit your household budget in terms of the cost of housing, but which is a 60 to 90 minute journey in the car to where you work. There is nothing just about living on the streets and begging for money. Access is a key opportunity to choice and diversity. It is not only the key to the door for a good life, but it does play a major role in terms of opportunities for a good education and a good job and being able to be part of a community. Plan Melbourne talks about a city of 20-minute neighbourhoods. Most of us connect with and associate with our neighbourhood. It is the place where we best belong, where we socialise, shop and recreate. It is at this level that we need to get the access to jobs and services improved, as well as greater choice of housing types, so that our neighbourhoods support young and old alike. Cities such as Portland in the USA use neighbourhood-level economic data to attract and match business to local areas and complement such economic initiatives with better walking and cycling links and reliable local public transport services. Neighbourhoods with a mix of services and facilities and hence more local job opportunities and which are well connected tend to be more cohesive and inclusive communities. The 20-minute neighbourhood can help improve health and well-being, reduce travel costs and traffic congestion, and reduce vehicle emissions. They can also create opportunities for for a greater diversity of housing choice close to where goods and services are located. So within the context of the neighbourhood unit, every neighbourhood should provide a degree of housing diversity and hence greater density, which in turn will sustain more services and create more local jobs. The 20-minute neighbourhood will not offer a job for everyone, but it will, if done well, create more choice and opportunity for Melburnians. And that essentially is the mission statement of Melbourne, Plan Melbourne. It is a global city offering choice and opportunity. So Plan Melbourne, I think, is a good start to Melbourne becoming a just city. However, I believe we will need more than just initiatives stated in this strategy to really signature Melbourne not only as the most livable city in the world, but the most just city. We have more challenges ahead. We can make Plan Melbourne an even better document to shape the future of our great city. And I would invite all of you to build on the directions and initiatives of Plan Melbourne through your submissions during the government's 8-week public consultation period. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Roz, for that. We're very privileged to have you here tonight to be able to comment directly on a strategy that you've had such a key role in crafting, so thank you very much. Next up tonight we have Jane Monk, Director of State Planning Services at DPCD.
Well, it's lovely to be here. I thought I'd just show you the Plan Melbourne, because not many of you will be able to get a copy at the moment because they're very hard to get. But you will have them on your tablets and other ways of getting it. It's a great piece of work. It's had a hell of a lot of sweat and blood from Roz there, and it's now on the DTPLI to-do list as well as the to-do list of the new Metropolitan Planning Authority. Look, I've been asked to talk about the implementation side of this Plan Melbourne and in the context of a just city. And we're going to have some super experts on just cities to come up, so I'm not going to talk all about that in particular. Except to say, and as Roz says, there is a revealing of cracks in the armoury of Melbourne, and we are starting to see things that manifest in that sort of two-speed economy side of things. So it's very important that you, as the planners of the future, keep your eye on the value proposition of the just city in your working forward. We can lose sight of what we've got once it's gone, you don't realise that you had it until it's gone. So we didn't realise that we could be more healthy walking around our towns until we got rid of it by moving cars into all the spaces. So that's the ability to be accessible in your 20-minute neighbourhood that the Plan Melbourne talks about. Until you've lost it, you don't realise that you had it often. So a just city is something, it's a bit about a value proposition that you as planners for the future should keep up in front and centre. Because we look at other parts of the world where there isn't a just city, where places are really, you know, where people live in slums, where people don't know what's going to happen next week, and we've got Syria and Egypt and the whole of the Middle East, it seems, and Somalia and everything. So let's get that sorted out. So the value proposition, and I think that value proposition, I'm looking at the toolkit that we have in Victoria around about a just city. And we have a good toolkit, and we can make that toolkit better. The toolkit for implementation starts from my perspective, and where I sit, you saw I was one of the authors of the current Planning Environment Act. The toolkit includes legislation. We have a Planning and Environment Act. It does capture justice and fairness. It's written in the objectives at the beginning of the Planning and Environment Act. Those have stood the test of time since 1987, but there's a good time now to refresh that and think about that. That's going to be a role for you guys into the future. It's had for a long time some objectives that talk about must consider the environmental effects of development. And just at the end of this month, a new amendment to that act is going to come we must not just may consider social and economic effects, it adds in you must consider social and economic effects where it's considered necessary to do so. And Kate and I probably first met in one of the very early cases of the Mandalay Apartments down in St Kilda, where we tried to push the must consider social effects, and we've got there now. We don't know what the horizon brings, but it's definitely part of moving to a more just city. That's at the higher end of the objectives in the Planning and Environment Act. We also have planning schemes that are created under the umbrella of our legislative framework. Planning schemes that include the State Planning Policy Framework, where the ideas that we're at Clause 11 at the moment talks about city structure, Clause 16 talks about housing affordability, and those principles, those value propositions about justice and equity are captured there. We've got to then make it happen, and we'll get onto that. The State Planning Policy Framework, like many things coming out of Plan Melbourne and the current government's reform agenda, State Planning Policy is under review. A committee is looking at that as we speak. Possibly an outcome is likely to be a more sort of spatial definition of what is otherwise quite a lot of statements about where we're hoping to go with this and that, and what other parts of government say about this and that. So it's hopefully a bit of a rebadging of that State Planning Policy Framework to give it a bit more spatial recognition. It'll pick up, absolutely can tell you now, the new Metropolitan Plan Melbourne. It'll also pick up the regional growth plans, and it'll be a bit like Tourism Victoria putting all the jigsaw together for and then, oh, there's Melbourne, there's Victoria. So that's a hopeful place where that will go, and hopefully, and I'm sure it'll articulate these issues such as addressing things like two-speed economies, because apart from the answer, a government like this doesn't like two-speed economies, because at the end of the day, it's not a very productive economy to have some of it not actually working. So it's an important time that we've actually got cities on the agenda. We've actually seen that these can be engine houses for the economy, and with that, let's make sure that that's an engine house for social satisfaction, for social compatibility, for a lot ends of disadvantage, and addressing that through accessibility. And so, as Roz was saying, at the end of the day, it's about getting everybody accessible to jobs, to schooling, to services, to parkland where you can feel better, and so forth. So and definitely to housing. Another part of the planning toolkit out of the Planning Melbourne is this new thing that many of you may work in. That's going to be the Metropolitan Planning Authority. It's a rebadging of the Growth Areas Authority that's been working on those greenfields area for some time. It's being rebadged as a Metropolitan Planning Authority. Its key performance indicator is to deliver Plan Melbourne, because if something went wrong with Melbourne 2030, the understanding is that no one was given the task to actually make it happen. So we have a Metropolitan Planning Authority whose KPI is to deliver Plan Melbourne and all of the justice and all of the equity that we hope that we see in Plan Melbourne. It's a group so far that has been delivering in growth areas, that is kind of significant change areas on the edges of our city, but it's now going to be looking at significant change areas within the city, so growth within the city. As opposed to the areas within the city which the government is now locking down with the whole new reform residential zone standards, and one of the zones is to lock down some areas where people can now go and relax and not get excited about what's going to happen over their back fence, but there will be definite areas where change will happen, and that's the quid pro quo that Plan Melbourne puts out there. The Metropolitan Planning Authority will not work very well if it doesn't work with local government, and Roz mentioned that. So one of the agents for change with the Metro Authority is to get councils working as regional groupings of councils, so that they can work harder together and actually see what's in it for them as a grouping, so that we will work Melbourne as a city of five sub-regions. So there's a sort of regional Victoria, we've got Melbourne, but Melbourne itself is a series of sub-regions, which a lot of academics in planning have been saying for some time. We are actually a city, and if we can just work it harder as a city of sub-regions and get those regional groupings of councils working together around housing strategies, identifying infrastructure, working with the Metropolitan Planning Authority to identify what needs to be done, and then fall in love with what needs to be done, so much so that we're going to have to find some ways of funding what needs to be done, and that's going to be something I'm going to mention shortly. We also need community buy-in, so that's part of your toolkit as planners. There's no point in going and putting a plan out there that the community is ostracised from and has an animosity towards. And in many ways, perhaps that's where Melbourne 2030 got towards its end. So this plan has been the subject of incredibly extensive consultation, and we need that community buy-in. The community does need certainty. Planners are change agents. The community often can't cope with change. So that's going to be part of your profession, is working around how you can be agents for change. Because if we're going to get to 6.5 million and or more, you're going to have to be working in a space that is changing and identifying and prioritising the areas for change. That's part of your plan to talk in. The planning system is going to have to be reformed. It's always on the loop. We're always reforming it and thinking of new things. But a real big change has got to be around the mindset of those that work within the planning system. It's got to be more outcomes focused. We can't sit down and think that we're just going to spend the rest of the day exchanging further information across planning counties and local government. It's actually got to be engaging you as planners to show, as Roz also said, you've actually got to be in moving this. You've got to be committed to what you want. You've got to be fighting for those outcomes. You've got to be engaging with the community housing sector, engaging with the development of areas, because it won't happen unless the development and the market are aligned to what we're doing. So we've got to bring them with you towards these outcomes. So we've got to get that planning system reform. We're going to have things like Cook Smart. It's going to get bigger. It's going to be starting to look at almost codified housing in significant change areas, and maybe we'll be using more innovative housing techniques of unitised building and off-site construction and bringing it together. It's not just on grand designs, but this sort of thing happens. We'll also be looking towards some funding models, because we haven't got a funding model that can deliver the sort of stuff that we need to do this with the infrastructure that we definitely need to make a more accessible city so that people can get to these jobs, to their schools, to their family, to be remaining connected. We're very connected in our IT phone stuff, but we certainly still need to have that physical connection with much of the things that we do. That costs huge billions of dollars. I'm working as part of I'm on the assessment, or setting up the process, we're not doing this stuff, but the process for this east-west tunnel at the moment. It's an interesting thing, but it's a very costly process. It's a very costly project, you all know that. And all of these things are very costly projects. The wonderful Metro Tunnel is a very costly project as well. How are we going to fund those? We're going to have to fund those out of, from us. The Victorian community is having to find a way to do that. There is a review of development contributions that currently is on being undertaken at the moment. Development contributions is a levy that is placed on developers when they're currently mostly in the greenfields area. But that would be being applied in established areas. It may be a different sort of a thing from what we've been used to here. It may be a completely different thing as a result of this committee that's been looking at this and developing models and working with industry. But that will be a funding model there. But it won't be enough even then. They'll have to be looking at other things where we capture value uplift from urban renewal through the Metropolitan Planning Authority, where we capture value from projects that have the market sector in there, where we do renewal in places like Dallas and Pariah, and we take benefit out of that. We'll have to be doing things. We're probably going to have to look at congestion charging, but I'm not saying that. But I'm sure that's on. It certainly must be on the list of things to look at. So you guys will be the guys. we're going to have to be thinking about these sort of things. How are you, as planners practicing into the future, going to be looking at this sort of ways of capturing value from the change that we're manifesting? And it has to be done. We can't do without the funds, and it's going to be us, our money as members of the community that will fund that. What will we forego as a result, you know, and how will we do that? And interestingly, just today, the Grattan Institute, so a great body that you should follow always to see the interesting things that they have around there, particularly housing and education and things like that. But the Grattan Institute, for example, is actually talking about the subsidy that we give to home ownership, and it's in the vicinity of some $36 billion annually, or something like $6,000 per household goes into the home ownership benefit, whereas the rental market doesn't get anything like that. The benefit to the negative gearing investment that the Grattan Institute is pointing out is something like $7 billion annually that is to subsidise. So we've got to actually look not just in planning terms, but in other taxation terms and so forth. So there's a lot of stuff out there for you as planners to look at as your toolkit and our toolkit, where we are in the department, the toolkit for getting some of this together so that we can keep on that value proposition that I said to you that we should be looking towards is a just city for all of the people.
Thank you very much, James. That was fantastic. Next up, we have Lucinda Hartley, the CEO of the CoDesign Studio. Thanks. And thanks very much, because I'm an alumni of this university, but this group didn't exist when I was studying here, so it's really encouraging to see such a great group tonight. I'm really excited about Plan Melbourne, and I'm excited because it's a vision for Melbourne for the next 40 years. And if we look in sort of time span, that is your and my professional career. So this is a challenge for us to think at the beginning of, I'm assuming many of us are working career, how we look at delivering what I think is a bold vision for our city. But I'm actually not going to talk in detail about the plan tonight because you've heard from the experts on that. But I guess I've spent what my short career has been today really trying to explore the intersection of design and social justice. I'm a landscape architect, and I guess my passion around social issues comes from a very personal place. When I was 19, at the end of my first year of uni, I went and spent 6 months working in Cambodia. I was actually teaching English at the time. But I was incredibly inspired and struck by one of the students in my class. Her name was Strenya. And what struck me about her was she lived in a neighbouring slum, had a very challenging life in so many ways. Yet the passion and motivation and drive that she brought every day to my terrible class really challenged me. As a first-year student, not particularly interested in studying, I saw her drive, and I remember thinking, if she can make so much of her life and circumstance, then what was I going to do with mine? And I knew right then that it wasn't going to be English teaching. I think I chose landscape architecture because I'm not very good at writing. You can see I can hardly even write in English. But I was, that left me with design. And I could see so clearly the influence that planning and design in these professions could have on creating spaces and opportunities for people to live. In one of my first jobs, I was again, I guess, struck by the fact I was asked from my desk in Melbourne to design an IT park in India. I was 23, I'd never been to India, and while I think there was a lot of merit in this project in and of itself, I didn't feel that it was possible for me in that circumstance, so removed from the situation, to meaningfully create something that would provide opportunities for those people. So that really got me thinking about how we could actually connect better with the end users. And I guess the process of co-design, which is the name of our studio, will be one that you may or may not be familiar with, but it's really about how do we create collaborative impact?
How do we work together with all levels of stakeholders to create shared outcomes? And I think that we belong to a profession that is steeped in issues of social justice. So if we look at the fathers of landscape architecture, Olmsted, and many others that you will have studied, we can see that many of the initiatives, the early initiatives in master plan cities, were in fact a response to addressing infectious disease, to providing democratic access to public open space. This is the heritage of our profession, which is incredibly exciting. But I think over the 20th century, we maybe have lost sight of that a little. We as a profession have progressively made it harder to get to work, more difficult to walk. To the extent that we now experience one of the highest rates of social exclusion anywhere in the world, deep social exclusion affects 1 in 20 Australians. 1 in 4 people, including in this room, this year will experience mental illness. And children now living in areas of Melbourne, certain areas, will have a 1 in 3 chance of developing obesity or diabetes. Now, I think that we actually, as a profession, have had a lot to do with creating and shaping environments that induce these. But I think also in the same way as 19th century planners use their expertise to overcome some of the challenges, that equally we can use our profession again to start to address some of these issues. But we need new models. And we need new ways of thinking about things. And I guess I want to talk tonight about how that operates on two levels. I think that, and I'm actually quite inspired by Jamie Lerner, former mayor of Curitiba. You've probably studied his work as well. He talks about these two principles, that one is design and the other is co-responsibility. And on the design level, I completely agree with Roz that we actually need intervention, that we need broad-scale, bold infrastructure initiatives that will create access and equality in our city. But equally, we need to establish a sense of co-responsibility. If we look globally, around 1.4% of the global population are built environment professionals. That's a very small proportion of people making a lot of decisions about how we live. If we are, in the next 40 years, and this is globally now, to look at doubling our urban population in actual terms, from 50 to 75% of the global population, that's a rate, an unprecedented rate of urbanisation that we've never seen before. So how are we going to catch up with the level of infrastructure that's needed to provide that? Well, things like Plan Melbourne talk about using our existing systems better, about thinking laterally about how to solve the problem, new housing models. These are all things that we really need to consider. But I believe equally to that, we need to look at how we can actually mobilise people like you and me to create that city together. So what that looks like for me is an approach to planning that is faster, cheaper, and more fun. How do we engage young people in creating, in partners in creating the city? How do we engage people like my neighbour who doesn't speak English and is illiterate? How do we engage people like her in being partners in delivering Plan Melbourne? We need new approaches. Just to give you some examples, our studio at the moment is working with the North Richmond Housing Estate to renovate the foyers of those towers. Now we're doing that by working with the residents to plan, design, and together implement really low scale interventions, okay? So this might be a temporary solution for about 3 to 5 years. But as a byproduct of having this very low cost renovation, we've got new relationships formed between people living in those towers in a way that wouldn't have been possible without this type of project. Recently we closed a street in South Bank and turned it into a park for a day. So this is an initiative that's been done in many places, and you'll be familiar with Parking Day. But these types of interventions demonstrate immediately the sort of change that you can make. It's the sort of change that you can achieve in a weekend. We've produced a toolkit, I guess, called Rapid Urban Revitalisation, coming out in November, which is 100 ways to transform your neighbourhood in a weekend. Now, these projects don't replace the need for bold infrastructure, but they do provide an opportunity for people who might not usually engage with planning to become partners in delivering the city. And I think this is a key thing if we're going to create a just and equitable city. So I actually work in private practice, even though that's a not-for-profit organisation, And I guess what I wanted to touch on in closing is the role, I think, of practitioners in delivering a just city. Because I think we can feel bound by our client brief or the confines of a project. But I think we also equally need to see ourselves as advocates. And I don't think that's going to be too difficult with our generation, because I see a groundswell of momentum of people who are demanding more of their profession, who are willing to push boundaries. Just in our network alone, we have over 700 professionals who are interested in exploring how you connect issues of social justice with built environment projects. So I think the answer for me in terms of practice is not necessarily better methods of community engagement, but a sense of collaborative impact. A belief that we can actually do more together. This doesn't replace the need for fantastic, great design, for good planning, but that we can achieve more infrastructure that's faster, cheaper, and more fun if we work together.
Lucinda. I'm just going to pause here for a minute and say we will be taking the questions after the following two speakers, so if you have a question, please write them down and have them ready to give to our amazing panel members. Next up, we have Dr. Kate Shaw. Thank you.
Thanks, Mitchell. Hello. I'm afraid Plan Melbourne tinkers around the edges of land use in the city. The great late Neil Smith said more than a decade ago that real estate development had become the centrepiece of the neoliberal city's productive economy, an end in itself, he called it, justified by appeals to jobs, taxes and tourism. In Australia in the decades since, it's become more the case. In rural areas, we dig up the land. In the cities, we develop it. It's also true that in terms of the distribution of wealth, Australian cities are becoming more unequal, less just. And the richest people in Australia are the miners and property developers, with very, very few exceptions. In the occasional meeting of gets into property development, keeps handling. There's a great deal of money to be made from land if it's put to highest and best economic use. That is, if the planning system enables the greatest possible profit to be extracted. And the planning system does. So for as long as this ideological approach persists, there's not much a metropolitan plan can do. It can deliver some shape, if not much in the way of content, to the development of Melbourne. The shape depends on linkages and connections, not just literally, but in terms of linking government departments and different tiers of government. And the architects of the plan know this well. As Roz has said, there's a very strong emphasis on integration and collaboration and holistic approach. So let's see how it stacks up. I'm just taking a couple of elements that interest me for today. The plan has an important emphasis on job creation and turning in the city. Now, matching employment and residential location is difficult at the best of times. And linking these can really only be encouraged by ensuring multiple transport options and increasing housing affordability so that people have some flexibility and can actually make choices about where they live and work. Planning government doesn't do too well on increasing transport options. Currently, there is no commitment to any public transport. Well, what's the wording? We're going to move towards a metro-style rail system. And of course, there is a significant political commitment to an east-west road tunnel, which will not only not solve Melbourne's most pressing transport problems, but will soak up further transport funding for generations. So at the most fundamental level, there's a disconnect between the planning department and the state coalition government. There is little in the plan that will actually increase housing affordability. Encouraging an increase in supply is the main mechanism, with no apparent acknowledgement that much contemporary new construction provides for the higher end of the market. There doesn't seem to be any recognition that there are different submarkets in the housing sector that have little impact on each other. That is, increasing the supply of high-end housing in inner city renewal areas does not increase housing affordability for those on low incomes, nor does it affect prices on the fringe, notwithstanding what the boffins of the EDIA will tell you. There is no mechanism in the plan that would enable government to regulate the type of housing built, notwithstanding interesting ideas to do with modular development and so on. This is all private sector. There's actually nothing in the plan that I can see, and certainly we'll discuss this at our presentations, I'm sure. But I cannot see any mechanism to actually regulate the type of housing built, which includes, obviously, affordability. Inclusionary zoning, a well-established tool nationally and internationally for acquiring a percentage of social housing in any new development, is not countenanced. There have been multiple submissions made from much more respectable people than like yourself over many, many years, and it has never been seriously entertained by DPCD or its current formation. There is no indication that the Department of Human Services, the Victoria Government Department of Responsibility for Public Housing, will be engaged through this plan to build more public housing. Nor does our admittedly utterly dysfunctional public land agency, Places Victoria, appear to have a role here. Susan, for your information, Places Victoria posted a $190 million loss in the last year, and unfortunately, this was not because of the provision of a large quantity of well-located, below-market rent housing. There was a more to do with internal problems. No, instead, it is local government that is expected to facilitate housing diversity and affordable and social housing, and it seems to bear, in the plan, the greatest load. Even though local government has significantly more constrained access to funding than the state. Housing affordability is a huge issue, of course, and it can't be solely addressed by the state government. The federal government and taxation laws also have to come into play in any serious attempt to address the problem, as indeed Jane points out, particularly with negative gearing and various other incentives to homeowners and investors. But a new state plan and strategy is an opportunity to bring the federal government into this discussion, and there is no evidence of a link here either, and consequently no indication of how this objective will be achieved. The best the plan offers is through urban renewal. So, some of the sites identified for urban renewal are vacant, but many are on land that is currently zoned industrial or commercial. That is, where the industrial and commercial jobs currently are. And they're predominantly along railway lines, or in other areas with good public transport, which currently allows workers to get to their jobs by public transport. And these are going to be redeveloped for probably not affordable housing, and the jobs are going to be relocated to where? The mixed-use philosophy is a nice one, but there are two problems with it. The first is, industrial uses often don't fit very well into a residential environment. The second is, that as soon as residential use is possible, it immediately becomes the highest and best use, that which makes the most money for its developers. And so the incentive and the pressure on the unwelcome lower ranking uses to sell up becomes unavoidable, which makes mixed use zones de facto residential, and that's a one-way trajectory. So this brings me to my final point for now, which is to do with all of the other uses that make a wonderful and real city. Where are the mechanisms in plan in Melbourne that enable affordable commercial spaces for small local businesses? Bars and music venues and bookshops and stores for local designers and spaces for not-for-profits and social enterprises and low and non-profit creative uses and artist-run galleries, co-ops, but community services and social services and other meeting places for people with modest means. So under objective four, we have a submission. Coordinate a whole-of-government approach to the delivery of education, health, recreation, and cultural facilities, and remove planning impediments to not-for-profit community services and planning systems. Great. How? The market doesn't provide these things. Not anymore. In new development, interest where higher and better uses are possible. That's why dockland is the way it is, and why fishermen's bend will follow suit, along with all the other planned urban renewal sites, if we don't experience a pretty serious change in mindset. But that brings us back to the centre, to ideology. And I don't think we could regulate our way out of that problem, even if we did want to. So where were we? Tinkering around the edges. There's been a lot of consultation and document production in the preparation of this plan, but some might say it's just going to lead to more business as usual. Thank you.
Our final speaker for this evening is Professor Susan Fainstein, who is visiting us all the way from Harvard, New South Wales, Sydney. We're very, very privileged to have her.
So then I thought, well, I'd listen to the speakers and really find out what's in it. I listened to Roz and I thought, oh my God, there's nothing I can even say because the aims of this plan encompass everything I proposed in my book. Nobody in the United States states that justice and equity should be the objective of planning. You can read Mayor Bloomberg's plan for New York, his 30-year plan for a more resilient New York. And it involves bringing in basically more high-end people, and then he was quoted as saying, but New York needs even more Russian billionaires. What they get will trickle down. So I'm really impressed that hearing somebody call for more social housing, when in the United States that's a word that hardly exists, because nobody endorses it. That what we hear there is a demand for a more competitive city. But then I heard Kate. What she said is, well, there were all these general aims, but that the actual practicalities and specifics of the plan really didn't give much of a room for getting to those general aims. And I guess what I would say is, at least it's progress if those are the general aims, because I'm not used to hearing that very much. However, the real question, just a political question, how do you get not the buy-in of communities, although that is certainly important and necessary, but the buy-in of those people with wealth and power? As I understand it, you now have a federal government which not only doesn't buy into this, but basically is antagonistic to it. So what does that mean in terms of the financial support for the plan? The plan without a financial plan is not really a plan. Well, some of it might be. Creating more open space is certainly always possible, but what can be done at the local level is limited by the kind of financing that the local level has available to it. The issue here then becomes, how do you support these big ambitions? I think it's very important. One of the things Roz mentioned, which is to me very significant, is providing access for people. There's a certain simplistic tendency among transportation planners to say, well, what we need to do is reduce distance, so everybody should be living by where they work. That is, in the modern world, completely impractical. When you have households which have several workers, we're not likely all to be working nearby. But what you need to do is provide very good transit. Well, I've now had some experience with the trolley system in Melbourne, which is very cute. It's fun for a tourist, but in fact, to get from downtown where my hotel is to here took about 20 minutes, and I could have walked it in the same amount of time. And this is an unbelievably slow system as compared to, say, the New York subway system, which may not be cute at all, but it does get you somewhere pretty fast. So the question that comes to my mind in terms of the plans is that I think the goals are very laudable. I'm really excited by hearing them because I don't hear them where I come from. But the question really is, how on earth do you bring them about? Where does the money come from to do it? The places that I've studied and the city I've most used as an example is Amsterdam, which until quite recently, 90% of the new housing that was built was in fact social housing. Amsterdam has retreated rather strongly from this, but at any rate, it was very committed to social democracy. It did build public housing. It does have actually a trolley-based transportation system, but also an underground and also a lot of rail, commuter rail. The reason that Amsterdam could do this all was because of the money that came from the Dutch government. Cities can do a lot, and it depends a lot on local planning for them to do it, but cities cannot finance what's needed. That it really requires a national tax base in order to provide the basis for development. I'm so cold, my teeth are shedding, so I sound like I'm going to go. But at any rate, one of the things where I said is growth is good, and I'm not one of the people on the left who says growth is a bad thing. Neil Smith was a friend of mine, and his loss is greatly to be regretted. But I think he kind of exaggerated the extent to which growth just benefited real estate developers and not anyone else. That without a surplus, without growth, without economic development, that everything's a zero-sum game and you're never going to catch up the resources necessary for greater equity. But greater equity does require that there be both commitment in terms of aims, but also a series of very specific goals that will produce it, and these are for housing, for public space. Public space is something that's most under the command of local government. But to have a really good housing program, you have to have national financing. I also do agree with Roz that public housing, actually supplying of housing by the government, is critical to having enough housing. There's been a move in the United States and in Europe towards rent subsidies rather than building supply. But rent subsidies do not create supply. Economists seem to think that just by increasing demand, the supply will come. But in fact, it won't. Developer contributions, I think, are good. And it requires, as planners, you really have to be able to drive a very hard deal with developers. One of the things that planners are taught now often are take courses in negotiation. The idea is somehow that you're the moderator and you play this intermediate role in the negotiating. But actually you are a negotiator and you're sure to travel with somebody who doesn't want to give up anything, so they don't have to. So what you really need to learn is what people actually learn if they're going to business, which is how to drive a deal. How to say, well, that won't do, and just get up and leave the room, which is usually the best negotiating tactic. So in conclusion, what I would say is that on the one hand, we hear a lot of old things. On the other hand, I hear people saying that Melbourne is becoming less just, and Australia is becoming less just. I don't quite know how to reconcile these two things I hear, but there just seems to be a kind of mismatch between very noble aims, and I endorse these aims and think it's certainly an important first step to have them, that rhetoric and words do matter, but that it has to be followed up with a commitment of resources.
Thank you very much, panelists, for what I can only hear is an impassioned call to arms or clarion call to us all. So I'm going to now put out the call to you to ask questions of our panels, and there should be a mic roving around the floor. I'm going to ask that you keep your questions quick and concise in the interest of getting as many questions available as possible.
You've got the mic.
All right, this is the second mic, so you'll have to take this mic. I think we have a question from up the back.
Certainly the Ministerial Advisory Committee advised the government that we should be staging and sequencing growth and actually putting more emphasis on redirecting some of that growth elsewhere, preferably in the established suburbs. On the inner suburbs, I think part of the problem has been that we have not been clear as to where we want density, that we've tended to, tweak around the edges, avoid the big questions, and hide behind council chambers in terms of making those decisions. So I'm hoping that at least Plan Melbourne will give councils in the inner suburbs greater direction as to where they should be putting more development, and obviously public transport routes are a key to that, as well as the urban renewal sites that they believe they have, as well as the underdeveloped public land that local councils own, such as at-grade open lot car parks, which are a complete and utter waste of space that sit in strategically well-located locations where they could be developed with minimum impact on residential because they're buffered by commercial properties. That's the sort of thing we need to see happening. When councils have the confidence to designate areas and use some of their assets to unlock that capacity rather than putting all the blame on the private sector every time they try to get an apartment development along the main transport route.
Obviously, the PSP process has been it's been both governments. So both sides of politics have been seeing the need to ensure that there is that nobody can challenge Victoria for not having a supply of land. So that's the deal there. And then in the established areas with the new zone reforms, it really is about. Addressing that community buy-in in some ways, that if you can be really sure that you can say there are some places where nothing is going to change at all, and the quid pro quo is that there are places that have to change, because we've known for 10 years that there are places that have to change, but we've been contesting that space. And I might say all sides of politics, and you would find, you know, Harry would be fighting against this, and Michael Buxton, another academic, would be fighting against change in establishment. All of our academia equally involved in the, so it's always been a contested space, so it's just trying to clarify and add some certainty and context to that. So if we can be clear about where things are going to happen and where things are not going to happen, then we can move forward, hopefully.
Yeah, I agree with you, but don't mark on that sort of thing. We have different views.
I think most of us do.
I like the bus, but it has the same thing as the board of law. That's it, yeah.
I shouldn't have paid.
I guess this is a sort of a supplementary question and perhaps a broader question about the question of justice, and I could have this completely wrong because I only read the beginning of the executive summary of the plan, but as I understand it, there is a plan to remove the ability to contest decided upon height limits that have been changed. And I wonder what the relationship between that and justice is. So if you take away the community's political contestation of the space and how it's negotiated by creating this certainty, what's the effect on justice of that?
I'm interested in considerations which assess also citywide benefits and not just local disbenefits. Very rarely in my experience, I'm speaking as a planner who's dealt with, I've been on both sides, I've worked for objectors, I've worked for developers, I've worked for councils, okay, so I'm not a hired gun, never have been. But one thing that strikes me is that it's time that we actually started to look at the citywide benefits of density rather than the personalised neighbourhood disbenefits. Now, I'm not saying that there aren't locations where you don't want change and where the change that's being proposed is appropriate, because clearly there aren't areas where it's appropriate, okay? But I think we all need to understand we have to house people, we have to provide affordable housing, diversity in the housing market, and we need to try and get people living close to their workplace and services. And that means that there will be areas, neighbourhoods, which have those strategic ticks, are not heritage areas, are not particularly areas of distinctive neighbourhood character, and we've got a lot of development out there that is not distinctive, and I think that they are the areas, if they meet the strategic ticks, we have to accept some element of change. And I don't think at the moment we're very good in communicating that and negotiating that with people. And I don't quite know how you do that, because boy, in the 16 months I've been involved in this project, I've met some pretty strange people.
Yeah, I'll just add to that quickly. I think the problem that I see in our public participation system is that you're allowed this very narrow opportunity to participate, that usually your only mechanism to be involved is to object to something you don't like. So already you're in a position of negativity, and you're not really asked to consider the broader issues. You're not given the opportunity to see how things might be beneficial to the city. You're given the opportunity, they're going to build five stories next door, I don't like it. And I think if we actually open up our public participation opportunities so that we have other ways to involve ourselves in creating the city, that we may reduce some of that antagonism.
I don't know how many of you went to the Docklands Forum that we held down at Docklands. Okay. I sat at a number of tables and it was young people who were saying to me, I am sick and tired of the baby boomers objecting to units in their street because that means I can't live in their neighbourhood. They are shutting me out of that opportunity, even if I could afford it, they are shutting me out of that opportunity to live in their neighbourhood because they don't want four units in their street. Is that fair? Is that just?
I think that's a very important point, because the whole problem with any system of participation is it tends to be neighborhood-based and therefore automatically excludes the people who aren't there. So if what you're talking about is supplying housing for people who aren't there, then how do you get those people to participate? And in general, there's a real difficulty in getting metropolitan-wide participation, because it's virtually impossible to do. But if you don't do that, then you're saying, well, the people who are there first are the ones who should have the final word. Also, I think there's a tendency among planners to exaggerate the importance of neighborhoods. That you can see it out there, it's spatially defined, so you know what it is. But for lots of people, their neighborhood isn't that important to them. Where they work might be more important to them. Where they go for recreation. People live on the internet. They don't necessarily even know their neighbors or care about their neighborhood. Their neighbors, they may care about their neighborhood, but it may not be such a high priority as we tend to think. It's just in the whole tradition of planning in the neighborhood unit. It tends to be the way we do think, but we ought to try to broaden our outlook from that.
No one has ever said that before in Melbourne. That is awesome.
I just want to pick up on Kate's comment of the lack of detailed or effective implementation of the plan. Is Plan Melbourne trying to plan for too many things, as it's not the only force influencing issues like housing or issues like justice? Or doesn't allow for things like soft policies to be implemented into other sectors? And I guess my question would be, or an additional question for that is, what are the connectors between those issues that would allow more effective implementation and plan Melbourne?
Oh, that's huge. I think we need a political environment in which there is much more robust discussion than it tends to be the case. Eric Swinger and Zizek and Ramsey are talking about this post-political, you know, this kind of consensus-driven model where everybody is just rushing into the centre and there's no dispute, there's no dissent any longer. And I think that's true. I mean, I want to see all of these issues. I mean, I think it's really interesting that in a forum like this that we have the position that Susan just put in and the question about how we rethink neighbourhood. And on all sides and in every direction, I think discussion gets kind of clamped down when it goes a little bit too far from the centre. One of the things that's particularly troubling me at the moment in this discussion is a little bit of a diversion, so I won't go too far down that track. But what I think is a major concern, particularly with a lot of the very, very high-rise apartment towers that are being planned and built for Melbourne, is that there is already a very strong sense in Vancouver and Toronto where there's been massive condo development that up to 50% of them are empty. And they're being used as investments, very safe investments from people, a kind of global elite, if you like, or some instances, some large economies, just a new middle class, seeking for a safe place to invest their money. And so the idea of having to rent them out is actually, you know, neither here nor there. So these these apartments are having a really interesting impact on, particularly in Vancouver, especially. I've written a piece for Planning News, I don't know if it's out yet, but about these guys that opened up a shop selling pot plants and little herb gardens and sort of space-saving sort of planting arrangements for people in condos with balconies, expecting that they would be flooded, as you would. And in fact, they say it's just a complete ghost town, and after 2 years, they've closed up, because most of the people, or at least half of the people, half of the apartments are actually unoccupied. There is also a capacity of Vancouver City Council to extract a levy, which goes into, very interestingly, goes into beautification. It's not going into childcare, it's not going into social housing, it's just going into beautification. So we have these cold, sterile, unoccupied towers, of towers. It's really quite extraordinary. So, in response to that, I would say, where is the squatting movement? I mean, this is an outrage. And I'm afraid that Canada has a very similar kind of consensus, kind of slightly complacent, you know, let's all be nice attitude, which is actually not doing us very well. So that is a diversion. But my question is, I think in order to achieve some of the kinds of shifts in thinking, we need effective and powerful resistance, we need a robust culture of discussion, and we need leadership. And really, on the political level, I think that the leadership in the context of justice, anyway, is bereft.
It's funded some really interesting projects around the world, like Paint the Favelas in Rio and some bike things in Memphis, Tennessee, if I'm not mistaken. My question is, I suppose, is do you think this system of crowdfunding has place in this private discourse? And if so, would it aid the development contribution system or even in that notion of a just city because it allows a deeper community participation?
I could start on that because we have crowdfunded some projects. I don't think you would want to crowdfund a new rail development, but maybe you can. I mean, look at the new climate commission. Perhaps that is possible to raise that kind of levy. But what I like about crowdfunding for small scale projects is it enables communities to be their own client. So I think you can feel a little bit powerless because you are lobbying always for a third party, usually your local government, to create some change. And while I think actually local government responds reasonably well in Australia compared to other places that I've lived, there is a sense of, I think you're right, in democratic process in enabling crowdfunded projects. They're not the answer to everything, but I think it enables you to do something immediately. You don't have to wait 3 years. The best place, and I'll finish just a second, that I think crowdfunding is useful is to pilot or test an idea. So you might want to redo something in your street, you crowdfund it, you do something, you might do it for 3 years, you prototype and test it and see how it works. That may be so successful that then you can convince easily your local government to develop a long-term strategy.
Thank you. Can I get one last question from the floor?
Going back to the idea of participation looking beyond the neighbourhood, I'm interested in how the sort of Metropolitan Planning Authority will work
Vancouver was my home for the last 10 years where I lived and worked there. I think I have some differing maybe views of some stuff Kate said, but one of the things that people generally tend to say work quite well is the metropolitan planning team there. One of the things they do is every mayor of municipalities that are part of the metropolitan area are obligated to be on sort of the metropolitan planning board. So all the mayors meet and talk with each other. And no sort of plan that happens in one city isn't sort of talked about with the other mayors. So I'm wondering what that going to look like here, and who gets to participate and who speaks on our behalf from our different types of municipalities, regional government, and things like that. But what is that going to look like? Because I think there are a lot of holes that's quite vague on what that will be.
Well, already across Victoria and including in the metropolitan area, there are regional management forums which are attended not by the mayors but the CEOs and also senior government people and Commonwealth people. So there's already a kind of a regionalised model where people get together and actually look for a sort of opportunity. I think that there's a potential to get that's going to be, those regional groupings are already existing and talking to each other. There hasn't got, you'll note I didn't mention the mayors, that's another side of it altogether. However, the Metro Planning Authority is going to be given the requirement to liaise with local government, but at a regionalised level. So it's not kind of picking off individuals, but seeing the local government to see the benefit of coming together to kind of work collaboratively around making that sort of sub-regional area work across consistently with the metro strategy. Is that sort of answering your question? I was not.
Not fully. I guess I was wondering.
You were speaking rather quickly and not really speaking into the mic. That's what I was wondering.
I was interested more in sort of maybe sort of any sort of mandated or mandatory things that would come out of this. If it's about sort of liaisoning with local councils, what does that look like? Is there any sort of mandatory participation by the councils in this authority? And again, it's who is participating and whose voices get heard within that process?
Well, at this stage, the Metropolitan Planning Authority is still early days. It has a board at the moment, and there will possibly be some changes to the board, but it's not like the Board of Works, the MVW, that was an earlier metro authority that had council kind of input into that, and in a direct sense, it's more of a relationship, as I understand. I could defer to Roz, who has a little bit more clue about that.
Actually, I don't have any more clues. As to the composition of the Metropolitan Planning Authority, I am not privy to that information. It's clear in Plan Melbourne that there are a myriad of tasks that will be set for the new Metropolitan Planning Authority to undertake, so it certainly has got a big job ahead of it. And Jane's quite right, its KPI is to deliver the strategy. In terms of local government, it is clear to me in the extensive consultation that I've been involved in that local government does want to be more active in the Metropolitan Planning Authority's decision making. I would prefer personally that there be one representative from each of the sub-regions having a seat around the table on the board. I don't think that's going to happen. If that is not going to happen, I would like to see advisory committees set up under each of the sub-regions whereby they advise and inform the Metropolitan Planning Authority Board of the things that need to be done and their priorities as well as their opportunities. If neither of those things happen, I think we are in for a rough ride.
Any last comments from the panel on tonight's discussion?
I can make one which doesn't bear on the question of metropolitan government, but I was very struck when Kate was mentioning these empty apartments, which are the case not just in Melbourne, but in a number of the so-called global cities, that these luxury buildings go up. The New York Times every Sunday features the, quote, big ticket item for the week. And we're talking about apartments that cost $80 million sometimes, and then they're inhabited for maybe a month in the year. The squatters can't get in these buildings very easily, unfortunately. But the other group, so we have these apartments that are empty, and on the other hand, we have a very large, in every advanced country, in every wealthy country, invisible population of the illegal immigrants, of the people who are refugees waiting to hear about their status, of the floating population in China, and this huge number of contract workers in the Middle East, in Singapore, so that and these are populations that aren't being planned for. They have no citizenship rights, they aren't consulted, they live wherever they can. If their legal status is in doubt, then they never have, they're fearful of voicing any complaint about injustice. But somehow this escapes the purview of planning almost altogether.
And there's a very clear meeting of those two problems.
I'm very sorry, but I can't take your question because we're completely out and over time, but I would encourage you to continue this conversation after we finish up tonight with food and wine we have outside, and as well as continue this conversation onwards. Can I just please thank the panel for joining us tonight. We're absolutely honoured to have this incredible panel here. I'm totally intimidated. We do have some gifts for you here, small and exquisite though they are. I'll get the camera off, Alex. I just have a couple of thank yous to add as well to our panel. I have to thank Professor Richard Tomlinson for getting Susan Fainstein to come all the way down here to Melbourne to join with us tonight. I would also like to thank Justin Cusack from the MSD office for filming tonight and helping us coordinate this event. I have to thank Facilities for allowing us to use this amazing venue and for helping us set up chairs and etc. And of course, these events never get put together on your own. I have an incredible committee behind me here, and to my side, Alexander Shako, James Conlon, who put together the panel tonight. Zina Bailey, Dean Steinberg, Chengjun Lee, and George Karen Philosophy, who also joins me in this incredible MUPSS committee. Thank you very much. Our last major public event after a packed social calendar this semester. You will likely have a new committee coming in next year, and I look forward to seeing what they achieve. If you'd like to keep updated with MUPSS events, please head to our website or to our Facebook page. If you're a student and not yet a member, there's a sign-up sheet at the door. As I said, please do continue this conversation outside. We have food and wine and cheese, and thank you all for coming out tonight on a cold night.